Good afternoon and welcome to the final day of GameCitySquared. Thank you all so much for staying with us to this, the highlight of the festival. Every year, we invite, in association with BAFTA, a particularly insightful visionary speaker to come to the festival to give their ideas, really, not just about what games have been and what they are, but really what they could be. So Lorne Lanning, Keita Takahashi, last year Alex Evans, and this year a completely extraordinary speaker and a completely extraordinary performance awaits you. To introduce this year's BAFTA vision statement speaker, I'd like to welcome to the stage, please, from BAFTA, Mr. Dave Green.
Thanks, Ian. Thank you all, of course, for coming. And it's quite embarrassing to get that much applause. So before introducing today's real headliner, I'd just like to say that as well as our annual awards for film and television and video games, BAFTA also has a year-round program of events all around the country where you can hear from and talk to some of the biggest talents in the business. You can find out more about these events and our online content by visiting our website or join our monthly email newsletter by filling in one of these feedback forms that you should have found on your seat. And if you hand those in at the end, we'll have a prize draw for a copy of a certain Parappa the Rapper game. Yes, be excited. And of course, speaking of which, it's a great pleasure to be here introducing today's speaker. His original Parappa the Rapper game, I don't think I need to tell you, made a huge contribution to broadening the audience on the original PlayStation. Do people still remember the original PlayStation? Fantastic. And I had friends who didn't like beat-em-ups or any of those other PlayStation games, but they'd come to me and go, oh yeah, no, we mainly use it for Vib-Ribbon. That's what we used to play our CDs on, and then this guy jumps along the screen. We don't really understand, but it's brilliant. And it was only years later that I discovered that it was all the same guy behind it, who of course went on to do many other titles that we've all enjoyed. He's the distinctive and innovative pioneer of the entire rhythm action genre, and he's also here to tell us what he's going to do next. Please welcome Masaya Matsuura.
Thank you. Thank you.
Thank you. I feel very proud to be a part of an industry that is truly without borders. Video games have given me an opportunity to make lasting friendship with people from every corner of the world. And I'm sure that Game City will be no exception. Today I will address the theme is where music and games collide, the past, present, and the future of the booming music game sector. I will, please allow me to use this kind of script this time. Usually I don't use a script, but today I will address a little high aspiration type of topic. So it's a little, not a little, but pretty higher than my English ability. So please allow me to use a script. So I have been making a music game for more than 15 years now. And during this period, many things have occurred both within the game industry and, of course, outside of it, too. But perhaps the recent changes that we are witnessing all around us are on a level quite separate to what we have experienced before. Today, I'd like to talk about and demonstrate some project of our that may shed some light on both the current state of affairs and the future of games and the part they are playing in the era of rapid change. I'll be speaking very broadly across multiple disciplines. My goal today is turn on the tap inside your minds, and hopefully you will figure out the answers yourself. Music game owe a lot to the huge impact that Guitar Hero and Rock Band had on the industry. From the 21st centuries onward, we can now consider music to be not only something that is heard and consumed passively, but also to be something in which we can all take an active role. The important thing to realize here is that this big change only became possible thanks to the skilled union of this, our global video industry, with the talent of other content creators. In the rapid progress of computer technology, remove one of these elements and such an impact just wouldn't have been possible. I'm not saying that forms of listening only musical media such as records somehow lead to incomplete experiences. Even now, I am an avid analog record listener. Without these 20th century technologies of recording and reproducing music, I'm sure that computer technology wouldn't have been developed in the way it has. Listening to analog records, wireless thinking from such angle is in itself a distinct experience. Through the development of computer technology, the world has become a smaller, closer place. This has made it so much easier to approach things more globally than before, and one of the major instigators of this growth has been video game. Since the distance passed, when people gathered, music was something used to help make the act of praying and worship into mutually shared experience. Right from the start, music was something social that spread virally. By thinking about the roots of music, it now seems perfectly natural that we have come to enjoy and experience music through methods such as rhythm games. After all, human beings are strange creatures that feel a compulsive need to express themselves. I'm interested in the primitive process by which music attained this shared ownership. This is because it doesn't matter how sophisticated the communication composition is, or how it is performed and produced. At the end of the day, without this primitive spark, it would never come to exist in the first place. I'm fairly convinced that spark is a key to our enjoyment, despite our best efforts to convey sophisticated message through our creations. In particular, in the case of children, we often see examples of primitive group musical expressions. To create these shared expressions simple, instinctively explainable rules are necessary. And things like this led me to think that there might be a hint here for discovering a new form of music. With a little leadership, changes to these social rules are suggested, adopted by the group, shared, and this development process leads to eventual stability. Let's take a look at an example. This is a dance group of children from the Republic of Chad in Central Africa. Sorry, video is an old one. I'm very interested in the next song. This is a very, sounds like a very simple song, but actually the musically, it's very complicated one. One, two, three, four. Maybe this kind of complicated beats impossible to play the another territories like here or in Japan too. It's maybe 4-5-4 means 13 speed. It's very complicated. Maybe if they can play this kind of song, it will be very proud to be something. Okay, this kind of play can be of course being seen all over the world, but it isn't enough as an explanation for what is fun about games. It is hard to understand why, but even without a clear explanation of roles or victory as a goal, for some reason, players manage to find some kind of enjoyment which is related to their conduct in games. This video taught me that game-like conduct is very useful when we are forming these kind of social relations. At a glance, why do human beings engage in these seemingly meaningless actions? And furthermore, why are they fun? Keeping these thoughts in mind, I'd like to talk about Desmond Morris, a zoologist who published a book called Man Watching in 1991. He talked about a theory called postural echo. There are many that disagree with Morris's view, especially in Japan, but I think that for the theme that I'm interested in, the observations and results are relevant. When two friends meet and talk informally, they usually adopt similar body postures. If they are particularly friendly and share identical attitude to the subject being discussed, then the positions in which they hold their bodies are liable to become even more alike, to the point where they virtually become carbon copy of each other. This is not a deliberate imitative process. The friends in question are automatically indulging in what has been called postural echo. And they do this unconsciously as part of a natural body display of companionship. Morris asserted that it is an unconscious act in general communication between adults. But in the case of children playing, I wonder if these postural echoes aren't more or less necessary for positive development between children. coming to understand rules that you previously didn't know, matching your behaviors in real time. From the beginning, we have no way of knowing if we will be successful or not, or even if it is fun. This kind of behavioral risk-taking or positive emergence is necessary. Yet, for children, their behaviors are not motivated by judging potential merit. Rather, don't you think that, as Morris suggested, it is more a case of children adapting to the other humans in their surroundings and behaving appropriately? Music has always been an innately social medium. But up until now, when the circulation of record music gets as far as social networking services, the process proceeds no further than the gathering of people's opinion. But with games, surely we have almost reached the exciting point where we can share these experiences in real time, much like the children we saw in Africa. Of course, it is also possible that something else like Google Wave may come along and revolutionize the speed and form of our communications. We have seen recently YouTube-led moving image technologies explode the internet arena from its still text and image-based roots. And I'm really looking forward to the upcoming development in real-time multi-process communication technologies and the improvement in experience sharing that they will bring. Let me introduce Ansan. This is a local project for the Japanese territory. If you would like us to release it in the UK, please petition your mobile phone manufacturer.
Good morning. Hey, why don't you say hello to me? Wow, look at your serious face. How come you're staring at the cell phone?
I'm not staring. We have been developing a new music game called Ansan. It's not like a usual rhythm game. The way of button input is a little different. If you control the timing of pressing the button and the duration of the holding the button, you can adjust the tempo of music.
What? That sounds very difficult to control on a cell phone.
No, it's not as complicated as you think. Operation is actually pretty simple. You see lots of animated notes and symbols, right? Can you see the numbers on the musical notation graphic? You just press the numbered buttons on the cell phone as the number shows in each region. In addition, you can decide the timing to press the button and the duration to hold the button, which actually make a player to be able to adjust tempo. If you want to make it faster, then press the button a little earlier than right timing. To make slower, need to press the button a little later than right timing. One of the other unique graphics, this animated strung notes flags means need to change the tempo to the particular tempo. And another is this green and yellow gradation means gradually change the tempo slower or faster.
What about this illuminated yellow arrows?
Okay, for example, this song being played is arranged by electronic guitar. When a player expresses a couple of guitar playing techniques like choking or vibrato, just press the pitch bend button or modulation button on a particular timing. Then you can see illuminated yellow arrow like that. Isn't it very unique?
Musical notation graphic has lots of animation. That looks really fun and makes a player motivated to play Ansan. There's nothing serious image of actual musical notation, so I can probably even play it. Let me play, it's my turn.
Okay, I will show the actual mobile here, so I will let you see the actual playing. But this game including the very beginner's level using just one button or any button until the very complicated one I will show right now is actually almost the same as playing the actual instrument. But I will show today is the most difficult one. It's very difficult. It is very difficult. On the rehearsal, I did a perfect play, but sorry about that. Okay, so game have a short history of wild growth, which can be attributed to the perfect alignment of numerous factors. Computer technology, a global industry, the culture, the economy. Perhaps it is fair to say that right now, numerous elements such as artistic expression, technique, industry, economy, and so on, are not thriving as much. This is why we must inspire ourselves to overcome these challenges. From my 15 years of experience in games, I consider the gigantification of project to be a prime cause of the industry's growth. As the number of people engaged in this industry increased, so did the general public's level of interest. I think that the PS2 was probably a key point in this process. Many new roles and procedures came into effect. For example, specialist graphic programmers now had to become even more specialist as the PlayStation 2's processor required them to write in hardcore assembly code. The sum of all these tiny changes led to big increase in risk. Whether we link liked it or not, project consultations became totalitarian affairs because otherwise the project just wouldn't get finished on time. Of course, going forward, there will always be cases where this is the best strategy. So I'm sure that this style of game project management will always exist to some degree. Unfortunately, I rarely feel that under this form of project totalitarianism, individuals involved in the project have no reason to think and take risk for themselves independently. Lately, I've noticed that developers who process these skills are declining, and this is surely a worrying trend. Such people naturally vary in experience and quality, but what they have in common is a certain way of thinking that tasks can be divided clearly between ones that are clearly their responsibility, and others are not their business. Nobody of work or industry can hope to mature unless they can develop an expansive, pluralistic outlook that goes beyond conventional definitions of what project, organizations, and international borders should be. I'm praying for an explosive increase of defiant people who are willing to challenge this sterile mode of thought. I'm sure that you are all thinking right now that I'm preaching to the converted. Here I am in the UK, a region renowned for their globalization of popular culture, telling you all to be more free thinking, even though I am the guy from the famously reclusive country. Another factor that is propping up project totalitarianism is the tools we use. For example, the majority of all musicians are making music with the same software. Of course, I have this. It is inevitable that they will end up sounding similar. It has now become the norm that music can be produced by oneself. Naturally, any musician should ponder not only the resulting greatness of this fact, but also the flip side. Lately, there is something that has been really getting up my nose. It is probably a direct result of what I was just talking about, but I really feel that most music nowadays has become monopersonal. When I make music, I always rigorously ensure that it intersects with multiple personnel. Please allow me to explain in more detail a little bit more. It is probably helpful to think that polyphonic music is one level below polypersonal music. The origin of this term can probably be traced back to Bach's two-part inventions. These were piano exercises that he wrote for his students that involved simultaneously playing different pieces with each hand. But in Bach's case, it is still vague whether the two pieces are intended to be one and the same person, or conversely, two different people. What I'm trying to stress is the latter. Sadly, I'm only able to compose music alone. Knowing this, I consciously put one or more phrases or parts into each song that I feel come from someone else outside of me. This is a polypersonal way of thinking. I'm sure that we could all come up with plenty of examples of symphonies that contain multiple parts and instruments, but really the number of them that really feel polypersonal are without doubt few and far between. Perhaps a good example is the music of Michael Jackson in the 80s. We can really feel a deep multiple layers of personality in each song. On the surface, mashup collaborations may seem like similar concept, but it differs to polypersonalism in that it lacks areas where the relation between the two parties seems to morph and intertwine dynamically. For me, it has been a while now since my body of work has shifted from music to games. But one thing that I have to apply and push these principles, it's the only way that I can devise and execute new game ideas. As we witnessed in the video of the African children and Morris's theory of posture records, polypersonal behavior is latent in us all. We should all base our conduct on this assumption. Okay, so now I will introduce some of my current project. We are very proud to be contributing to one big game, the world's most ambitious video game charity initiative. When Martin Delon, a good friend of mine and the founder of One Big Game, approached me with the idea of making a game for charity, I was determined that it must be something polypersonal. Charities are a great opportunity to collaborate and share opinions. And on this occasion, we are very lucky to be co-developing a game with our friend Triangle Studio in the Netherlands. Today, I would like to introduce Winter to you. Winter is an acronym for War is Not the Answer. They are lyrics from a Marvin Gaye song in the 70s. It has been 15 years since I first started making the rhythm action game Purpose Rapper, but even after all this time, the template of rhythm game has hardly changed. With Winter, I want to break open this subgenre by providing a platform where anybody can release a music game. Today, I will show you an early prototype, but the eventual goal is to have an easy to play, attractive rhythm action game that any musician can contribute their own music to by using simple tools. But as I told you, this is a very early prototype, and the graphic expressions and various things are still ongoing. So please allow me to show not the well done things today. And also, I will release this program game, including my song first. And I will approach it to other artists to contribute the same project. I really appreciate it. Okay. Okay. Have your life changed for the better? Thank you.
Why can't you be friends? What is not the answer? Not fighting each other.
Yeah, thank you. But of course, this is very early prototype. So our goal is providing that this kind of framework for everybody can make a music-based, rhythm-based game. Okay, I will play the next song. Is the same song as the game Hearts. As I told you, this song, including the polypersonal concept. Maybe you can listen to my phrase. Is kind of a voice track as a melody, but at the same time, that you will feel the same feeling with listening the bass phrases. So bass phrases and the melody are the two different things coming simultaneously. So this kind of design is thinking the way of the polypersonal example. Please check it out. Thank you very much. Even the song for winter has pretty personal theory, history. And I already did it. Sorry. Let's move on. Let me introduce a little big way to improve innovation in the studio. This is very interesting episode in our studio. So I will introduce the things happened in our studio. Recently, we made a major minor's majestic merch for Wii, and we have a very young lady entered our studio recently. And she had a chance to join the competition to make the very small, tiny musical effect after your game stage has been cleared. It's a kind of a score counting scene, just a 10 seconds or some time. But I really frustrated to make the just the 5 or 10 seconds of music. It is not our music at all, just something like music. So after the competition, the winner was her. So I asked her to make the entire whole song by using the small musical effect. So this is a story about how she got frustrated and upset by having this kind of theme. Let's take a look.
Thank you.
This is a very interesting project for me also. But the last song, it shows an approved version. But actually, I really don't approve it perfectly. Yeah, she did a very good job, but the biggest point I want to say is that she couldn't remove the symbolic recognition as the original musical effect as fanfare sense of the from the musical effect. That she couldn't remove that. So that she put the original musical effect as the top fanfare feeling and adding some others besides the musical effect. So I will let you listen to my example. I already perfectly removed this kind of fanfare feeling from the original musical effect and adding completely totally different concept of the music with that a musical effect. Let's listen. Thank you. These days, thanks to a new platform like the iPhone, anyone with willpower can make a game. So really, there is no excuse for stagnation. I really want Nottingham to take these kind of examples and to go on and self-motivate herself to always push for greater things. In this respect, the emergence of fascinating indie games like Music Box and Audio Surf is a matter of great interest to me. These were both productions made by an individual or at best a very small team. And this goes to show that music game can be a great match for solo developers. From a musical perspective, games have at the very least equaled, perhaps even surpassed, other musical meta elements such as video clips and dance performances. If we focus closely on the development we have made in the relation between music and games, interactive media, not to mention social networking and other new forms of expression, then we can say without any doubt that we have merely touched upon the possibilities that such integrations can facilitate. Up until now, we have only managed to uncover one of these elements, rhythm games. But they are just the tip of the iceberg. To paraphrase, it is not so different to the situation of a newborn child whose eyes yet to open. The act of birth is truly a miracle, but the true test comes with what we do with the child from then on. Of course, children can grow up even if they have no parents, but this is a very unstable time of their lives. Children need a lot of care and encouragement. So for me, it has become a personal mission to do whatever I can to nurture this young category towards its full, wonderful potential. However, 5 years from now, we are sure to see vast amount of peripherals on the scrap heap. That is something that I would hate to see. I'd like us all to think a little more about how we can improve sustainability of our products, both on the manufacturing side and the user experience side. Lately, I have come to feel that music games as a genre is starting to outgrow itself and is now challenging us to expand its possibilities. Music really is an art form of putting abstract ideas into certain forms, and this made me think, isn't that basically what a game is too? Music is mysterious. Particularly for me as a musician, I noticed that in our memories, we are very clear about its independent existence. However, in the external physical world, it has never had an independent existence. People, races, paper, tools as musical instrument, records, images, parties, these are all various ways for us to make our connections with other people stronger. The number of people who believe that these very coexisting relations are themselves music are not as few as you might think. Musics that stay in our memory often have associations and information attached to them, which are very difficult to separate. Actually, I don't suffer from this so much personally. Perhaps I'm just a forgetful and heartless. Whilst making music is an individual creative act, once music enters the physical world, it becomes very difficult to redefine the properties of its existence. Here we can see a hint about why music is so hard to define. But these days, many people listening to their songs in shuffle mode in their iPod. The way that people encounter music is changing on a macro level. Without doubt, these kinds of social, societal changes are altering the way that our memories perceive the music that we listen to. From now on, we will see a similar upheaval as packaged games become the norm, following a similar path to the music industry. Of course, this naturally means that the way we personally experience games will also change. An example would be a situation where a player can take their full HD games, scale down them down to 320 by 240 at 15 frames per second, and play them on the road, or perhaps have a whole bunch of games running simultaneously and just switch between them seamlessly. These are all things that could easily be a reality 1 year down the road. Who knows? Perhaps you will even be playing beat-em-up games with actual robots. This is a kind of fun future that I would like us all to experience together, hand in hand. The future is in our hands, so let's all do what we can to make it bright. If someday we reach this future and some of you remember the things we discussed today, then for me, that is the greatest honor. Whilst I have been to the UK countless times, this is my first time to visit Nottingham. Wouldn't it be great if sometime in the future we once again find an opportunity to collaborate? I sincerely hope so. Finally, I would also like to thank all of my staff who helped me prepare for this. Thank you, everybody. Thank you very much. And I will play the last song for you.
Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you. Thank you.